Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alex Vines. I'm the Director for Area Studies and International Law here at Chatham House and head of its Africa program. And I'm delighted this afternoon to be in, well, hosting, receiving the Right Honourable Raila Odinga, the party leader of ODM, back to Chatham House. He has spoken here before, and as you know, he is the leader of Kenya's opposition coalition for reforms and democracy and leader and founding member of the Orange Democratic Party. He served as Prime Minister of Kenya from 2008 to 2013, and prior to that held senior political positions, including Minister of Roads, Public Works and Housing, and as Minister of Energy. He was appointed also as the African Union Special Envoy to Cote d'Ivoire in 2011, and has worked on conflict resolution issues in Mozambique, Burundi, Nigeria, and Zimbabwe in collaboration with the International Republican Institute. I'm personally very grateful to you, Raila, for coming today. I know you've just come back from a busy time in the US. I think you attended the Republican convention, did you not?
Democratic
one, sorry. You see, when I was reading International Republican Institute, I was thinking maybe you did both. So, the Right Honourable Raila Odinga is going to be talking about the importance of democracy in Africa, Kenya's experience. And this, obviously, is a meeting that is fully on the record. You've got journalists at the back that are filming us. So forget anything you've ever heard about Chatham House rule, because it doesn't apply right now. So, Raila, I don't know if you want to sit or stand at the podium, but over to you.
I prefer to stand.
Please do that.
Well, let me first begin by thanking Alex and the Chatham House fraternity for inviting me to come and talk to you here this afternoon. As he has pointed out, I'm coming from the US, where I attended the Democratic Party convention, which is ending today. And I had to actually reorganize my program and cut short my stay in the US. Therefore, I was not able to be there when Madam Hillary Clinton was delivering her acceptance speech, because I wanted to come and talk to you here this afternoon. So I chose the subject of the importance of democracy in Africa. This is my second time talking to you people here. Maybe the audience has changed a little bit. I was here in 2012 when I addressed an audience here. Now, let me begin by those who don't know me or are familiar with me, that by stating clearly from outset that I'm talking to you as a Pan-Africanist and an Afro-optimist, as opposed to Afro-pessimists. That Afro-pessimists are those who have given up on Africa, those who say Africa is a lost cause, that Africa can never ever come out of poverty. But Afro-optimists are those who believe in the ability of the African people to develop Africa. Now, I want to talk about democracy in Africa, and I begin also by saying that I believe that democracy is a universal concept. I'm saying this because there's some people these days who want to say, oh well, it is Africa, and therefore standards need to be different. I say that I don't agree that we should have lower standards for Africa, that Africa is part and parcel of human race, and therefore the bar should not be lowered when it comes to African democracy. I begin by saying that from the pessimism of the past, when Africa was seen simply as a basket case, ruined by conceited and ruthless dictators, Africa has now become a puzzling case of rapid economic growth in the midst of promising political changes. Nonetheless, this new dawn may easily be jeopardized by the reluctance to embrace the far-reaching democratization at the political level and progressive reforms at the economic level. Both require committed political leaders with long-term visions that were typical of our founding fathers, like Kwame Nkrumah, Mwalimu Julius Nyerere, and more recently, Nelson Mandela. Yet democracy is in jeopardy in Africa in the second decade of the 21st century. Many pro-democracy activists in Africa are no longer sure they have the support of the West. Many are not clear if it is still the policy of the West to stand only with regimes that promote open, free, and fair elections, transparency, good governance, and human rights, or we are in the era of anything goes. I'm saying that this is not the first time that we saw this kind of development. Soon after independence, some of you may, through reading, know, or those who were there, that a very typical development took place almost all over Africa. The founding fathers of the continent began to say that Africa was different from the rest of the world and talked about traditional African society, which provided for resolution of conflict by way of consensus. Leopold Senghor argued very eloquently, he called it palaver, that people used to sit under a tree, they dialogue, and then an agreement was reached. Dialogue, as he called it, or palaver. Kwame Nkrumah equally argued eloquently, and they say that multi-party system was alien to traditional African society, that the African society allowed for conflict resolution through consensus, as I mentioned. And therefore, through a series of measures, coercion, blackmail, bribery, the opposition was led into extinction. And that saw the emergence of single-party dictatorships, then moving on to military coups and military dictatorships, or one-man rule, the strong man syndrome, as that is why Monsieur le President, the president. So there are indications that the West is turning its back on democracy by cutting funding, endorsing regimes with dubious records, and abandoning democracy, activists, and civil society. In those days of Cold War, this was the case. The West was more obsessed with the war against communism. So if you came up and said that you are an ally of the West in the war against communism, nobody cared how you were running your country. You could do whatever you liked, but you got all the money that you needed. That's how we created the African strongman. Idi Amin Dada could kill hundreds of thousands of Ugandans. And still he was elected as the chairman of the Organization of African Unity. Mobutu Sese Seko, Kumbuza Banga, also did the same thing in Congo, killing opposition members and so on. Kamuzu Banda of Malawi could go live on a BBC interview and say that his opponents, Chiwumi and Chipembere, if they dared set foot in Malawi, would be delicious meals for the crocodiles on River Zambezi. Jean Badel Bokatsa of the Central African Empire, because he converted the country from a republic to an emperor, crowned himself the emperor of Central African using millions of dollars of public funds that were public in the country. So what he was saying is that this had happened It was only with the fall of the Berlin Wall, when the wind of change began to blow in Eastern Europe, that it started also blowing on the African continent, bringing down these dictators, the single party, military regimes, and reintroducing political pluralism on the continent of Africa. But when that wall came down, only three sub-Saharan African countries were classified as democracies: Botswana, The Gambia, and Mauritius. Elsewhere, presidents for life and single-party dictatorships held sway. A seismic change has since happened from that time. Out of 55 countries that make Africa today, over 25 are considered democracies of varying degrees. Africa had 22 competitive elections in the year 2012 alone. At least a dozen sub-Saharan African nations have held or are due to hold presidential or parliamentary elections this year. One of the shortest-lived military coups took place in Burkina Faso early this year. It was the country's seventh military coup in 50 years and was staged by presidential guards loyal to the deposed ex-president Blaise Compaoré. It lasted just 7 days. The Financial Times quoted one of the coup leaders saying, and I quote, "We realize the people were not in favor of that. That's why we quite simply gave up." As the Burkinabe repulsed the coup leaders, in Nigeria, voters elected Muhammadu Buhari as president, making him the first opposition candidate to defeat a sitting Nigerian president through the ballot. And the defeated incumbent, Goodluck Jonathan, conceded defeat. That had been almost unthinkable in Africa. The gender trap, too, is giving way in African politics. The US is having its first female presidential candidate in Mrs. Hillary Clinton. And I express my bias. I hope that she will win and become the first woman president in the US. The UK has its second female prime minister in Madame Theresa May. Africa, on the other hand, has had three female heads of state this century. Ellen Johnson Sirleaf in Liberia, Joyce Banda in Malawi, and Amina Gurib Fakin in Mauritius. Most countries in sub-Saharan Africa are currently witnessing lower economic growth rates than those seen over the past decade as a result of the continued adjustment to lower commodity prices and higher borrowing costs. However, for much of the past 20 years, some of the world's 10 fastest growing economies have been African. Even with the slowed growth, Africa is still growing faster than most developed economies. Secondary school enrollment in sub-Saharan Africa grew by 48% between 2000 and 2008, while malaria deaths declined by 30% in some countries and HIV infections dropped by up to 74%. Life expectancy has also surged by between 20 and 42% across Africa since the year 2000. Of the 37 countries to have seen life expectancy rise more than 10% since 2000, 30 are in sub-Saharan Africa. In Malawi, for example, life expectancy rose from from 44.1 years in 2000 to 62.7 years in 2014, according to the World Bank records. In the past decade, real income per person increased by more than 30%. In the previous 20 years, it shrank by nearly 10%. The World Bank Economic Forum places Ivory Coast, or Côte d'Ivoire, as it is also known, as Africa's fastest growing economy, with expected GDP growth of 8.5%. It is followed by Tanzania at 7%, Senegal at 6.6%, Djibouti 6.5%, Rwanda 6.3%, Kenya 6%, Mozambique 6%, Central African Republic 5.7%, Sierra Leone 5.3%, and Uganda 5.3%. The message is clear. Countries that have adopted accountable and democratic governance systems have made strides on the social and economic front. These countries are reaping the democracy dividend that ensures sound management of public resources and political stability through regular, credible elections and peaceful and predictable transfers of power. These gains created a prolonged period of stability that allowed a new wave of investment. So far, so good, throughout the picture. However, as I said at the start, these gains are threatened by the absence of sustained momentum for deepening democracy in Africa. I want to agree with the former UN Secretary General, Kofi Annan, who said, and I quote, "Democracy is not just about one day every 4 or 5 years when elections are held, but a system of government that respects the separation of powers, fundamental freedoms, like the freedom of thought, religion, expression, association, and assembly, and the rule of law." Any regime that rides roughshod on these principles loses its democratic legitimacy, regardless of whether it initially won an election, unquote. The Washington Post, in a recent editorial, said, again I quote, "The tyrants of today are more sophisticated than those of the past. Rather than outright totalitarianism, they erect a facade of democracy and subvert it from within. They hold elections that are not competitive, use government-approved shell groups to edge out genuine civil society, pass laws outlawing free association and speech, and force the news media into submission by pulling the strings of the owners and editors. They brand as foreign agents any group receiving money from abroad. These trends are ongoing in Africa. And what has become the vogue is that elections are held as a ritual, which must be won by the incumbent at all costs. And the election observers will come weeks before the elections, stay mostly in the capital cities, at the end of it, then give a verdict that though there may have been flaws here and there, by and large, it was the reflection of the will of the people." Regular multi-party elections have not translated into good governments and respect for the rule of law and fundamental freedoms. That's why there's new thinking that rather than focus on elections alone, there's need to focus on building freer societies separation of powers, independence of the media and the judiciary, devolution of power and resources, restriction of on presidential power and respect for term limits. While the West has previously underwritten democracy, it appears to be pulling back. In the current issue of Foreign Affairs magazine, respected scholar Larry Diamond says, and I quote again, "One of the biggest challenges facing democracy today is that its biggest champion, the United States, has lost interest in promoting it." Unquote. I agree, and it is a sad development. When you see events taking place, like recently, we had elections in the Eastern African countries, which even some observers do not know how to describe. And you see what is happening in Burundi. And you see that the African heads of state meet, and their concern is not about what is happening in Burundi, but more how to pull out of ICC, because one or two heads of state in North Africa are charged in ICC. Then you actually begin to understand the magnitude of the challenge that Africa is facing today. Africa's elections are being judged not by how free and fair they are, but how peaceful. The performance of incumbents is getting judged by how they can be used to fight terrorism, no matter the human rights abuses that accompany the fight and the economic gains that come with doing business with those regimes. First is, they are an ally in our fight against terrorism. So terrorism now becomes more important than democracy within the countries itself. If we don't cooperate with them, China is going to edge us out. So let us forget about whatever this may be, a bad guy here and there, but we need to have a piece of the cake. So look the other way around as far as abuse of human rights are concerned. My focus on elections and what happens between elections is informed by experiences in Kenya. One electoral cycle is enough to wipe out all the gains made over a prolonged period of time. In December of 2007, after 5 years of steady economic growth under the NARC government, Kenya was suddenly thrust into a political crisis following a botched election. Botched elections, everybody knows what happened. From an 8% annual rate of growth, we dropped to a miserable 2% in 2008 after the post-election violence. That is why since 2013, Kenya's opposition has demanded fundamental reforms to the electoral infrastructure as the surest way to safeguard democracy. We are pursuing reforms to the system of voter registration, the counting of votes, results transmission, and announcement of the results. We are pushing an electoral body that operates in a truly open and transparent manner, with an obligation to complete the disclosure of all its operations in the conduct and management of elections. These efforts in Kenya and elsewhere in Africa need the backing of all forces that believe in democracy. They require that the US and the EU, and I don't know now the role of Britain out of EU, must do more for democracy, must fight corruption, defend internet freedom and the media freedom, and protect democracy activists. You remember during the elections in Uganda recently, they completely shut off the country. They could not penetrate, use the internet, supposedly for security reasons. It is our hope that the next president of the US, together with the EU and Britain, will support democracy in word and in deed. The West must show unequivocal support for civil society and the rule of law, accountability, human rights, and free and fair elections. The march of democracy is to be guaranteed. And I conclude once again by saying that so far, gains have been made, but we are now witnessing regression, and that is need to remain on course, which will continue to propel Africa on this growth path. Because right now we are seeing the rate of growth beginning to drop as commodity prices have gone down, and that the economies have not been diversified to be more competitive. And we are seeing the rise of corruption on the continent, which is diverting vital resources from public to private hands and pockets. And therefore, it is important that we continue on the path of reforms to ensure that this growth is sustained for the benefit of the African people now and the future generations. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Raila Odinga. We now have 25 minutes for questions and clarifications and discussion. I have to say it was a pessimistic picture that you depicted of Western policy toward Africa in particular, moving away from values, particularly the value of democracy, to one of interests, particularly mercantilism, I think is what you're suggesting. But maybe we can discuss that. Who would like to ask a question? So I'm going right to the corner over there first. You've got a tall arm. And do tell us who you are.
I'm Andrew Weir of Africa Confidential. Sir, can you tell us what you are doing and what the prospects are regarding what most people seem to believe is an increase in tribalism in Kenyan electoral politics?
Thank you. We'll take three questions. So, gentleman right here, right in the front row.
Hi, I'm Connor Gaffey from Newsweek. You've obviously just been at the Democratic Convention in America, and you said about the US having to support democracy in word and deed. Do you think that both the presidential candidates, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, would be able to do that?
Thank you. Gentleman right here on the corner.
Thank you very much. Godson Azu from London Political Summit. I'd like to find out, sir, you sounded very optimistic about African democracy. Can you tell us what you think about this new idea coming out of Africa that is called Afrocracy? Afrocracy. I think it's a new ideology by some politicians in Africa trying to redefine African way of politics from the Western way of democracy. Is there anything you think that you understand about this whole thing, about this new wave of Afrocracy ideology in African politics?
Thank you very much. So, Raila, you have three questions there. Thank you for each of the questioners for being short and concise.
First, on the issue of the role of tribalism in Kenyan politics. This has got historical roots. It actually started from after independence, the way the country has been governed. During the struggle for independence of the country, people were very united as one people against the colonial system, or colonial rule, as it were. Because to the British colonialists, everybody was just a bloody African. So this, of course, made the people to come together to fight and remove the colonial masters. Unfortunately, the nationalist movement split immediately after independence. And when you see the role of the elite in politics, because it is the elite which use ethnicity or ethnic discrimination in competition for resources in the country. And you find that the leadership will surround itself with an elite from their community and say, oh, we are the ones who are in power, and these people want to take power from us. So it becomes us versus them. And that is the genesis of tribalism in Kenya. The British had tried to use it slightly toward the end in what he called divide and rule, but it became more enhanced after the independence. You contrast Kenyan development with that of Tanzania. When you had the Mwalimu Nyerere, a Pan-Africanist, who created higher values to which people could aspire and promoted what was called Tanzanianism, or Tanzania, as he called it, or Tanzania, so that people were united as one people and there was no ethnic discrimination in Tanzania. So I'm telling you about the historical background of ethnicity in Kenya. It is still a factor in our society today. It is still being used by descendants of those who introduced it in our country's politics. It's not a factor that you cannot ignore. But ethnicity in itself is a major impediment not only to integration and unity of a country, but also to its development. Whereas people with talent are discriminated upon merely because they come from this community and this other community, and mediocrity is promoted. Basically, disillusionment begins to reign. People become disillusioned. That is itself what is responsible for immigration, particularly of the African intellectuals, out to greener pastures, because they cannot get equal treatment in their own societies. It is something that we must stop in our country. And that is the reason why we are addressing it. We are addressing it with a view to eliminating its role in our society. US role post-elections. Of course, I've been to the US now for the last 5 days, and I have witnessed the intensity of the campaign that's going on between Republicans and Democrats. I think that for the first time, I've been going to the US, these conventions. This was my fourth convention. I was in Chicago, I was in LA, I was in Boston. But I think the issues are very clear cut this time around between the Republicans and Democrats. I don't know that if Republicans have a policy on Africa, if they have, I did not hear it. But I believe that there may be some positive changes if the Democrats win. I have had the opportunity to discuss with senior Democrats senators, like Senator Kuhn, Christopher Kuhn, who has been on Africa or on Foreign Relations Committee. And they clearly have a vision for Africa, which in my view could help Africa deal with some of these negative developments that we are talking about, if they were to implement it. Afrocracy in my view, is something that is basically being invented by those who are hell-bent in fighting Pan-Africanism or trying to misuse Pan-Africanism. Those are the people who are trying to be more inward-looking, to say that you need to apply completely different standards for Africa. Therefore, you see that the leadership is forming a kind of a bond that will lower standards in Africa, trying to basically defend themselves. You've seen these efforts at limiting the, or removing the term limits. It's a trend right now where most of the leaders who have been were forced by the wave of that wind of change I talked about after the fall of Berlin Wall to agree to introduction term limits are now removing it under the guise that the people want them, that without them there can be no stability in the country. This is happening, and that's why you see that Burundi can be in that kind of state where people wake up in the morning with dead bodies on the streets. But you see that most surrounding countries in the Eastern Africa region cannot come out strongly and face Burundi. The AU cannot send troops to poor Burundi, basically because they have this problem that I may find myself in a similar situation tomorrow. So they are unable to act. You have this situation where Kabila is now trying to postpone the elections under certain a disguise that some reforms need to be done. Now in Sierra Leone, they are trying to do the same thing, that there was Ebola, and therefore 2 years were lost. The president should be added another 2 years. So on and so forth. Then even Japan, they could have asked for extension of the time for elections because there was a tsunami. I basically come down to what I'm saying, that there should be no different standards for Africa.
Just stay there, Raila, because I'll get a more cluster of people. And let's start in the far corner there first, and then we'll come along.
Hello, Honorable Odinga. My name is Nancy. I'm a Kenyan citizen. My question is, do you think there's a democracy in Kenya, yes or no?
Thank you. That's exactly the sort of questions we want to hear. Please, the lady just then. Do tell us who you are.
Mr. Odinga, sir. I'm Anne Cormack from Rolls-Royce. My question is, your picture of democracy and Africa more generally is inspiring when you hear it from you, together with all the warning signals. We have had Africa, if I may say, on a watch list, but in a world that is becoming more uncertain, how can you help business to be more confident in investing in Africa?
Thank you. And I've been discriminating to my far right, but maybe your far left. So, gentleman in the front here, there with the pen. Do tell us who you are.
Thank you. Morning, Honourable. I'm Robin Gwynn, now in the business community. You mentioned a number of former African leaders that you admired, and you've recently mentioned a number of current African leaders that you admire less. I'm wondering, as you look around, are there current African leaders that you commend as doing the right thing at the moment? Thank you.
Okay, and I'll take one more. So, gentlemen, just there. You, sir.
I'm Julius Baluto. I'm a broadcast journalist. Your Honorable Raila, Kenya has got the most progressive constitution right now, a very progressive constitution, but that's not enough. If you ever become the president, what will you do to ensure this rule of law and the laws are followed by everybody?
Thank you. Honorable Raila, I think you've got plenty on your plate there to answer. Over to you.
This is there democracy in Kenya? That's a $2,000 question. I think that can even be tied to the last question. I'm going to combine them because they talked about the rule of law, what we can do. It is true that we did reforms in the country. We came up with a new constitution in 2010, which has been billed as one of the most progressive constitutions, a very comprehensive Bill of Rights chapter in our constitution. But you see, the thing is that the constitution is a document. Its implementation is another matter altogether. You have a situation where you have people in power who don't believe in that constitution. They actually opposed it during the referendum. And what they've been doing is trying to subvert it through legislation. You have had several subsidiary legislation brought in and passed by parliament, which are in effect trying to amend the provisions of the constitution. Like, for example, the Bill of Rights itself. Under the guise of Security Laws Amendment Bill, they came up with provisions that are aimed at muzzling the media, for example, restricting the freedom of speech and movement, and so on and so forth. Some of these amendments, which were illegal, have been challenged in court. Luckily, the judiciary, to a certain extent, works. So we have had some of those amendments overturned by the courts. But and even the devolution, we have, for example, a provision for devolution in our country. You're having a problem. I'm told a governor addressed an audience here. I hope he told you the kind of problems they're having with the flow of resources to the devolved units, how they're being starved of funding by the national government. So if you take this together, you would say that the Kenyan democracy is on hold. It is on hold. You ask, what do we do? Because democracy is about strong institutions which are working. So what I would do would ensure that these institutions are working. Because individual human beings always tend to do the wrong thing sometimes. But if you've got strong institutions, the institution will correct them and weed out the wrong people, generally. This, I think, is what's happening in this country. Because, see, it's not that if you talk about corruption. Corruption is everywhere. See, but what is different is how it is dealt with if it is discovered. You have a typical case here where a British firm was contracted to print ballot papers for the Kenyan Electoral Commission. The officials of the Kenyan Electoral Commission demanded that they be given a bribe before the award of the contract. And this company is called Smith and Usman. The officials gave a bribe to officials of Kenyan Electoral Commission. The Serious Fraud Office in the UK investigated this matter and arrested the officials of this company, Smith and Usman, and they were prosecuted here in the UK. I think one or two of them are in jail. But back in Kenya, the recipients, which those the ones who demanded or who made it a condition for awarding of the contract, are working scot-free. And the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission in Kenya is saying they have no evidence to prosecute these people. So you see the double standards. So that is what makes this country different from Kenya. And investors in Africa, yes, Africa by and large today still remains one of the most profitable places to invest in. What we've been talking about is to making it even more safer for people. Because during this period I'm talking about, from the 90s, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, that period has seen the highest rate of growth on the African continent. From in the 90s and after 2000 and 2010. This is the growth which is now beginning to again slide back. This is because there have been also the societies became more open and more attractive to FDIs. A number of the private companies came and invested on the continent. But then corruption is now on the increase, which of course, you know, scares away investors from the continent. And that's why I'm talking about building stronger institutions, because they say it's very too costly to do business in some African countries today. So we want to create an enabling environment that will attract more investment on the continent. And here, there's the issues like security, infrastructure, bureaucratic red tape, and corruption, which are major factors which scare away investors on the continent. Do I know progressive leaders on the continent? Yes, there are some progressive leaders in the continent. One of them is Mr. Kama of Botswana. And the way you see, Botswana is one of the fastest growing economies on the continent. And he's the only one who stood up when the AU was saying, let us pull out of ICC and MAS. Said, no, look at what is wrong with you, rather than blaming the ICC. Because there has been this blanket condemnation of ICC that is targeting African leaders. I say that is hogwash. Number one, the African leaders are there because there's more violation of human rights on the continent than on the other, any other continent today. Secondly, African leaders who are charged in ICC were referred there by Africans themselves. So ICC did not target Africa. Mr. Taylor took refuge in Nigeria. He tried to escape. Nigerians arrested him and fought and sent him to The Hague. Mr. Bemba of DRC is there because of Kabila, the complainant. Mr. Kagame took General Nkunda, put him on the plane and sent him to The Hague. Mr. President Gbagbo, the former president of Cote d'Ivoire, I was involved in negotiating peace in Cote d'Ivoire, and I pleaded with Mr. Gbagbo to agree to hand over power because, in my view, he had been defeated. He refused. And then the palace was stormed, he was arrested. Ultimately, he was sent to the ICC by the government of Cote d'Ivoire. But I went there with a pledge to offer him a refuge in the United States of America, which he refused to accept. In our own case, we brought a bill to Parliament to set up a local tribunal to try the suspect of post-election violence. It was opposed by the very same people who ended up being accused in The Hague. They said that The Hague is much better than a local tribunal. A local tribunal will be influenced, that let's go to The Hague. In fact, the clarion call was, don't be vague, let us go to The Hague. So this is a complete nonsense, saying that ICC is targeting African leaders. But Kama stood out to say no. And in a number of other resolutions, he has been the sole voice of reason in a continent where we're seeing the emergence of strong men.
Right, one more round of questions. I'm going to be disciplined, so each row gets one. Just here, no? Right there. Do you want to ask a question?
Yeah.
Okay. There you go.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Julia Falukia. I too find your view of democracy quite refreshing. I wanted to ask, you said you're an Afro-optimist. What are you most optimistic about in relation to democracy in Africa?
Thank you very much. So, you, sir, then? The microphone is just coming. Please keep your question concise. We don't have much time.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Odinga. I have a great respect for great fathers like Patrick Lumumba, your father, Odinga Odinga. But the dream they had in 40, 50 years ago has faded away. The optimism you have, I don't share. Young people are pushed out of their countries, driving taxis. Doctors, engineers are driving taxis on the streets in London, Europe, and America. Environment is getting polluted. Few people in power are counting their fortunes in billions, while people are starving. Sir, we need more from you people, active people like you. You've got the voice. If I write a paper to the Guardian, they wouldn't publish for me. But you, as concerned African leader, please help by airing the voice of disadvantaged African people for good, please. Thank you.
Could you just tell us who you are so we know?
My name is Dr. Bekele Gasese, environmental scientist.
Thank you very much. The lady right at the back there.
Thank you. My name is Raki Ismail. I'm a local councillor in London. My question is to the Right Honourable Mr. Odinga, is that my ethnicity is Somalilander, and I was wondering, does the Kenyan parliament ever will accept Somaliland as Somaliland, especially when Somalia, we know what's happening? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And sorry, we're running out of the time. So the gentleman right at the back there, you sir, no, right there. Final question.
Good afternoon. My name is Zachary. I'm a Kenyan student here at London School of Economics. And my question to the Right Honourable Prime Minister, you mentioned something to do with brain drain. So for my case, I'm pursuing a master's course here in environmental sustainability, and environment happens to be a field in Africa that has not received much attention, and there are problems. But unfortunately, I'm almost completing my course, but there are no government programs to absorb the skills that we've gathered here. So as most of us sought to join corporations and other international organizations, but we never have the opportunity to work directly with the government. So as an opposition leader, are there programs that you can forge that might help absorb skills before they are diverted somewhere else? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry, we've run out of time. So Honorable Raila, if you could answer those four questions.
Yes. Afro-optimists, what are we optimistic about? they say that there's always a light at the end of a tunnel. I've talked about challenges which are facing Africa, and I've given a picture that the progress has been made, but we are seeing a regression. So what I'm trying to say is we don't want to surrender, because we know that we can actually get where we want to go. So what I'm putting out here is a plea to the international community not to help these forces of retrogression who are now on the ascendancy. They are fighting back, you know. They are really fighting back and trying to claim lost ground, and they should never be allowed to do so. I mentioned to you that in those years, what we call the wasted years, from the 60s to the 70s to 80s, many Africans suffered seriously at that time when the West was dealing just with the strong men on the continent. There was stagnation. Most countries were realizing negative growth. At the time when, of course, there was a lot of generosity in dishing out aid. Aid, you find a number of countries became heavily indebted. They became hippies, heavily indebted, without anything to show for it. Most of that money which was being pumped in the continent was finding its way into the pockets of individuals, bank accounts in Switzerland, in Guernsey, in the Canary Islands, and so on and so forth. So it just impoverished the ordinary African people. But when that changed, then you can see there's a turnaround, and the economies begin to register higher rates of growth. And most of these countries have been able to repay some of the debts, although they are repaying debts which did not do anything to the common man on the continent. So I am optimistic that ultimately the forces of progression, of progress, will succeed. African voice. Of course, the African voice needs to be heard. At the moment, we have a situation where when African leaders meet, they talk more of their own problems, but they do not address the serious issues which are of concern to the continent, which need deliberate action. One of them is this issue of intra-African trade. Africa trades more with other continents than with itself. I mean, look at Europe here. Europe trades more within itself than with the outside world. You see, the intra-African trade is estimated to be worth over $2 trillion today. But very little of it is being used. Why? Because lack of infrastructure. And this requires a deliberate effort by the African leaders themselves. At the beginning of the last century, there was a Boer in South Africa called Cecil Rhodes. Cecil Rhodes conceived this idea of a trans-African highway from the Cape to Cairo that should be constructed. Today, it has just become a pipe dream. Nobody has thought of making it a reality. It is how did they develop the American continent? Deliberately, by constructing rail lines from the east to the west and opening up the interior for development. When I was the Prime Minister of Kenya, I came up with this idea of what we call LAPSET. LAPSET means Lamu Port. There's a small port in Kenya called Lamu. We wanted to build a port there. Lamu Port, South Sudan, and Ethiopia Transport Corridor. To construct a rail line from Lamu to Juba in South Sudan, and another one branched to Addis Ababa. But that was phase one. Phase two is to extend that rail line to Bangui in Central African Republic, the Congo, up to the Cameroonian port of Douala. That will create a land bridge linking the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean and opening the interior of the continent. Then Nigeria can hook in, Chad can hook in, Niger, and so on and so forth. Because how does Kenya, for example, trade with the Central African Republic? Just behind up there. Or with Chad, or with Nigeria. You have to go around the coast, Cape Coast, that is Cape Town, up. By the time you reach West Africa, Europeans are much faster than you there. There is just behind. These are things that can be done. These are the issues which should be discussed at the conferences of African Union. At least one positive thing they did this last time is to come up with Pan-African passport, which if you now have, and I hope they're going to begin to give it on a larger scale, you can then travel in the continent without having to have visas. They're businessmen, like my friend Aliko Dangote, Nigeria, who is want to invest in several African countries. He says to travel across Africa, he has to carry 27 visas. 27 visas. You have a situation where a friend of mine from Nigeria, a business friend of mine, is in Kampala. He wants to come and call on me in Nairobi before he goes to Nigeria. He cannot do it because he does not have a Kenyan visa. A situation where school children, 17-year-old school children from Senegal, fly to Nairobi to come and play. They've been invited by schools in Kenya to play basketball. They're detained at the airport for 2 days and departed back to Senegal. That's Africa for you today. Because you ask yourself, what kind of animals are these? So these are things which must change. And you don't need rocket science to bring those kind of changes to the continent. Okay. Somaliland, I am myself a strong supporter of recognition of Somaliland. And I've said so without fear of contradiction. I've said this, that I've been to Somaliland. I was one of the first leaders to go to Somaliland when my late friend Mohammed Regal was still alive. And I saw what they had done at that time. And I know the history of that union between Somaliland and the South, which is not helpful. Now you have a situation where the South itself will take many years before they sort themselves out together. I think there's a very strong case for recognition of Somaliland as an independent state. But I'm speaking as Raila Odinga, not representing any government. Okay? Yes, Zachary, there's a brain drain on the continent. And I'm not just lamenting, I'm saying there is also lack of recognition of expertise, and that's why you find very many African professionals outside. You go to the US universities, you find very many of them, like in Kenyan diaspora. You find them in Harvard, you find them in Boston University, in Columbia, in California, in Princeton, and so on and so forth, because they're not being made good use of. In a situation where you've got Chinese professionals, they come and do research in Harvard or in Columbia, but then they have an arrangement through which they go back to China once in a while and teach in Chinese institutions there, and also do research there, so that they are able to transfer knowledge and know-how back to China. This is a situation which we have not created on the continent, which we can and actually should do. On the issue of environment, we've been saying that Africa is a victim. But not just a victim, because Africa itself is also a major contributor to environmental degradation. How we have destroyed the forests on the continent. It's a major factor. Right now you find the snow on the top of Mount Kenya is melting away. The same thing with Mount Kilimanjaro. But when you tell them about protecting our environment, it becomes a big issue. Being a Kenyan, you remember my story with the Mau Forest conservation and all the other water towers in the country. When I started to do this, I was accused of targeting my voters, that I was doing this deliberately to cause suffering over people. But I said, this is something that has to be done if we have to really properly conserve and preserve our environment in the country and in the region generally. So we have a responsibility, but you know, we have been involved, of course, in these negotiations which have been going on, including the latest in Paris, where an agreement was signed. And there are several programs which are available in the country. You remember when I started Clean Lake Naivasha, I came here and working with the Prince Charles Foundation managed to access funds that have helped us to basically rehabilitate Lake Naivasha, where fish was dying in large scale. And now we turned it around, and the water is now fresh, and the fish is now very clear, back again on Lake Naivasha. There are several programs that are ongoing in the country, which are being implemented by the government. I'm sure that there will be a place for you somewhere in the country. Let me say in conclusion, I started by saying that I'm an Afro-optimist. And I believe that Africa is going to be able to reclaim this century. I've always believed that the 21st century must be the African century. And I would say that this is the century of the African lion. And the African lion is giving a message to the Asian tiger. The message is that you have danced on the stage for far too long. When I was asleep in the jungles of the Congo, the European bear retreated a long time ago to the poles, and the American panda is also limping now. I am now awake as the African lion, and I am sitting on top of African gold. They're bounded in the east by River Nile, the west rivers, Gambia and Niger, the south Zambezi and Limpopo, and the east mountains Kilimanjaro and Mount Kenya, the west the Atlas Mountains, sitting on African diamond, African gold, African bauxite, African oil. And I have what it takes to transform this into wealth for the benefit of the African people. And I will do just that. Thank you very much.